Clearly, you know about Philippine history. It's close to your heart in one way or another. And Sabah has been a part of the Philippines' history. And you spoke about it with President Marcos Jr. in 2018. That's the irony of it all. Did you talk about it now?
Well, I mentioned it because is quite contentious because the position of the Philippines and the historical antecedents of Malaysia, Sabah is part of Malaysia. It is you are very comfortable with it, but I think to be fair to the Filipino opposition, they have not taken a very extremely hostile or aggressive stance. So let this evolve. Slowly, although it is tough for us because our people in Sabah feel that we should be more assertive in defending. But I think the president has been very cordial in the sense that that's the Filipino position, that's the Malaysian position, but let it rest for a while. It should not be an issue that would be easily provoked or cause antagonism because too many things in common, and these are two great nations. They must work together. I represent this generation, and I told the president very clearly that let us work together to enhance these bilateral relations, as had never happened before.
Another interesting point is just February last year, before you actually took your oath as Prime Minister, a French arbitration court ordered the Malaysian government to pay $15 billion to Sulu claimants of Filipino descent. And I'm curious, how will your administration deal with this? Do you even respect that ruling?
We have won subsequent cases. I mean, this is some claimants on an individual basis. The Filipino authorities have not been involved in any manner. They've got solicit some professional counsel from the UK, taking a certain cutback. So I don't think it is a decision that would affect the sovereignty of nations. To us, it's our national sovereignty. There are, of course, contentious issues regarding interpretation of agreements, which we can resolve. I don't think I'm hard and fast on that. But to give this ridiculous, frivolous claims. There were faults in our legal process, but then it's been corrected, and I think we'll continue to win the cases.
You're hitting 100 days in office, interestingly, this week as Prime Minister. What would you say is your biggest achievement in the last 3 months? I know it's too soon,
Yeah.
but I guess short term, low-lying fruit, what would it be?
2 weeks, 100 days. To me, it is inconsequential because, of course, this is mainly the legacy of American administration, a policy, particularly, I think, from the days of Roosevelt. But I think what was important from the first day was your message: good governance in the country, rid the country of corruption, get a clear framework in what development means. We cannot ignore and marginalize some segments of the community to remain abject poor and to allow for such gross disparity from the very rich and the very poor. And the country must free itself from endemic corruption. Malaysia should not be known because of these various past scandals. So I think from day one, I give that strong message. I make clear that no way will I compromise on this. So I think that to me, whether it's one day or 100 days or 100 years, we must begin now, and we have done so.
Let's start with that, since you mentioned corruption, the one MBD scandal. Sadly, Malaysia has been coded all over the world because of a sovereign wealth fund gone wrong, right? And you've demanded Goldman Sachs to already pay off. Where are you now with that? Where is Goldman Sachs?
You see, as I've said, this sort of treacherous deals and of course absconding sovereign funds could not have happened if this national system, with judicial independence, professional prosecution, and independent institutions, central banks, etc., had been intact. there are some flaws. But it could not have happened in that scale if the international financial institutions like Goldman Sachs is not complicit to the crime. So it's a tough stance. And we cleared it to the Goldman Sachs. And it's not right for you to say now we'll pay you some minor compensation. Yes, it was done by the past, the previous administration, which I think was clearly not complicit, but at least certainly didn't focus on these issues. And I've changed. I've dismissed the legal team and the entire team and work again, because I think I owe it to the Malaysian people. I mean, why do we need to pay billions of dollars to the complicit crime of others? So I take that position, and we are reopening, of course, the case and negotiations with Goldman Sachs. And they can't say, well, it's over. No, it's not over. Yeah, 2 days back, we settled with Abu Dhabi Investments, the IPIC in London. We obtained $1.8 billion. Which is a major success. I mean, we thank to the not only the team but also the Abu Dhabi authorities for, you know, trying to resolve it amicably and move on. But only through leadership with integrity, if you don't have any side deals, can you regain what was lost.
Now, Malaysia's also sued JP Morgan and Deutsche Bank. Are you willing to negotiate with these two banks? Come up with a settlement too?
Yes, even with Goldman Sachs. It is better if they can come up with some, you know, reasonable proposals that we can adjust, other than having to be dragged to court for years. I mean, I am in favor of you know, quick resolution. If we can get some of the returns. We may not get 100%, but it must be a fair deal. You know, these financial institutions with all so-called experts cannot be complicit, and they cannot just let be squat free without taking some responsibility for the misdeeds and malfeasance.
You've always led in an argument of righteousness and justice, anti-corruption, even when you were an opposition leader. And in some of the interviews I've seen, they've also brought up issues about you working with your deputy prime minister, who's charged with 47 counts of corruption. You're also accused of nepotism. How do you balance this now?
It's not balance. We had to form a coalition. Any party, in order to form government, will have to enter into a coalition process. Now, the president of the party, who is now deputy prime minister, has been charged with some technical offences. You know, I don't understand why it is 47. Clearly, it's also questionable how it's being done. But nonetheless, I said, it's not my issue. We have to respect due process. He has not been convicted. He has alleged that this is malicious prosecution, but I have advised him to go through the process. I have not interfered. So what's the issue? Oh, the opposition says, well, because of the fact that he's being charged. I said, well, let's look at the record of this opposition who were then in government at that time. And the complicity with many of the corruption cases sometimes far exceed that. So let us then go through the process. Let the Anti-Corruption Commission conduct their affairs. Then if the Attorney General decide to prefer a charge, then they will have to answer in court. But what we cannot compromise is interference with the judicial process. Now, it's not nepotism, because they brought up, I wanted my daughter to just advise me pro bono. I say, what is important in the country is governance, that you do not interfere in the contracts, you do not take money, and you do not squander money. And it is appalling. I mean, for people having the corrupt who have taken billions, who have appointed their son and their son-in-laws and given hundreds of millions of contract, to have the audacity to come back and say, well, this is not nepotism. I mean, this, but notwithstanding, because of the perception, my daughter then opted to resign, you see, which is unfortunate, because in this field, she has taken a strong stance. But, you know, this perception is important. Mm. And they say part of good governance, what I have talked about, good governance and anti-corruption and against nepotism, fair. But nepotism is appointing people and squandering and influences policies at the expense of the state.
You have had a stellar life. Your political journey is short of miraculous, one would say. You've been incarcerated twice for charges that other people can't even imagine that would fall into their own lives. How could you be here right now and not be bitter, not be angry, still smiling and run the country?
Karen, you were, of course, familiar with the case. You were there.
Absolutely.
Since 1999, interviewing my wife, and you understand the predicament. It wasn't easy. Prison is not bed of roses. I mean, it's not twice, three times. Even prior to that, I was also detained because of the student demands, protests against the treatment of the poor farmers in the north. But between your personal predicament and the nation, the nation takes precedence. Mm. And we have to move on. I mean, people do make mistakes, but they should not repeat it. Now that I'm in charge, I said, I will not tolerate this nonsense. Mm. Whatever they say, they accuse me in terms of governance, we have to save the country and allow Malaysia to reemerge as a vibrant economy, as a nation, mature democratic society. Mm.
What do you think did being in jail with those trumped up charges, that kind of political harassment, what did that teach you that's helping you become the leader you are today?
Wiser and older, unfortunately. No, I think, Aaron, what I did was a lot of time to reflect. You meditate at the same time. Mm. You keep yourself healthy, not out of choice, because they don't give you enough sugar. Mm. No meat.
This one, no meat?
One wow. year was no yeah. meat.
Wow.
Right. So your cholesterol level is very low, controlled.
Yeah.
Sugar is very well, controlled. Mm. So there's also the positive side of the imprisonment. But you spend a lot of time, hours and hours, 8 hours, 10 hours a day just reading whatever I can find. The classics, the philosophy, the religious texts, and great.
Mm. And I have to ask this because you have such a unique relationship with former Prime Minister Mahathir. You were once his protege, and then until it turned sour at one point. What's your relationship like today? Do you talk to each other?
No, we are not in communications as much, but I think we have to move on. Mm. I don't have an issue against him. It is he who sacked me.
Yeah.
He put me into prison, and I got tortured when he was Prime Minister.
Mm. Have you and forgiven him? How could you move?
He reneged on the promise.
Yes.
Which is a major surprise after all that's happened, and we have forgiven him and moved on. I said, it's immaterial whether I forgave him or not. I just want to move on. He's 97. I think he has to move on and make sure he has good health and peace of mind. Mm. But my task is horrendous, having to repair all these past excesses. And I think it would be good for me, Aziza, and the family, and the nation, if we have a leader who's fully occupied just about helping the nation grow. Mm-hmm.
Two last questions for you. I know they want me to wrap up. You're 75 years old. You look great. What's the secret? No, really?
A doctor wife who's strict with the diet.
Okay.
No, not... I don't know. I mean, I tend to have a good regular exercise, have a good, diet. Oh, I can't do it in Manila. You've been serving me too good food. But
really, what
moderation.
Do you do?
In moderation. In moderation. Mm-hmm. I try to catch up with good sleep, which I fail, of course. But I'm lucky. Mm.
My last question is, very few people get to your position. All over the world, you have very few personalities that are almost revered, right? Nelson Mandela, at one point, Aung San Suu Kyi. How do you not lose the Anwar Ibrahim that the world knows? The compromise is tempting along the way. Then you can lose it all. Mm-hmm. The reputation you've built, the admiration of the world. What do you do?
Well, you have to draw the line. Of course, there are a lot of compromises. Given a choice, I would have done, you know, better in many other ways. But I think that you draw the line. For example, governance on the issue of poverty, on the issue of anti-corruption. I think if you draw that line, you will be able to succeed. I think, and not too obsessed about what others think, you know, like most politicians do, having to be excited about every time there's a poll, okay? But just do what is right. I think that's important. Yeah, and finally, I believe, we say inshallah, God willing, if you do what is right, then there is that satisfaction. Spiritual, mental, that you know you do your best. It wouldn't satisfy everyone in the days of the social media. Mm. You know, it is not easy, but I'm generally a happy person. I mean, I'm relaxed, I'm happy, I don't get too engrossed with all these problems and details. You know why? Because I went through hell already. Mm. So it's not going to be worse than what I had experienced.
On that note, Mr. Prime Minister, what an honor to be speaking with you, sir.
Thank you.
Really, what an honor.